So I want to start there.
Okay.
Well, actually, if you would start with slide 53, okay. I just want to check with all the library folks and make sure I have the right second floor. I've gotten this wrong, so I want to make sure to correct myself.
Let me make sure I have the right one, Ellen. Does this look right to you?
I didn't add anything until the you get to the Soap Creek Saloon. Just a couple of quick more. Yeah. Okay, yes, this is the right version. Well, while we're here, remember we had a very great discussion about Soap Creek Saloon, and I found a picture of it in an Austin Chronicle article, and that picture is on the right. That was in the 70s, and performers there in about that same time period. And let me see if I can find the quote. If you back up one slide, Colleen. Go forward one. There we go. If you notice the quote at the top from that Austin Chronicle article, if the Armadillo World Headquarters was the heart of Austin's music community in the early 70s, Soap Creek Saloon was its soul. I thought that quote was great. The other quote that followed directly after that was, the rundown shack of a venue was on what was then a godforsaken stretch of Bee Cave Road, and the rutted dirt trail that led to it was even more notorious. So that's what people shared with us at the last meeting, but now we have proof with newspaper articles and pictures. And if you want to go to the next slide, Colleen, we added this one in. Based on our conversation.
Oh, gosh. Is that Charlie Pride?
That is, yes. Charlie Pride and Willie Nelson.
Very wow.
Much
oh,
younger.
Yeah. Oh, my wow.
God. Colleen found that on the
Austin Dazed and Confused Facebook page. And if anybody hasn't looked at it, it is a great Facebook page for all kind of fun Austin stuff.
Okay, and somebody's telling me they can't access with the go to the West Bank Library calendar and use that link. Okay, I'm gonna see if she can get in that way. Alex is trying to join, Alex Bradley. Okay, what else did we add in based on our conversation last time? If you scroll on down now to 53.
No, I don't have a number here, so you'll have to stop me.
Okay, just go real quickly. Yeah, keep going.
Did all that.
Yeah, we did all that. There. Okay, back to
now. Oh, yeah, those were the, no, there.
Back one more, please, Colleen.
Back more?
Yep, it's right there. Okay. I want to ask all of the library-oriented people, have I got the right building for the original, that where the library was in the second floor? This is the Chase Bank building.
Yeah. Oh,
yeah. I think so.
Okay.
and it's worth knowing that there is a, the road constantly gets messed up there, and a fault line runs right under that bank.
Not a good place to build a, it's interesting. That is relatively close to Hill Country Middle School. And for years, we have had problems with a spring underneath the track at Hill Country Middle School that, we think we've used all this technology and gotten things secure. And lo and behold, 5 years later, the problem comes back. So I wonder if the geology of that whole stretch going down towards Barton Creek is a little unstable.
Mm-hmm. What was the name of the geology teacher at the high school? I'm just a blank at the moment. His wife was an English teacher there as well.
That's not.
Not ringing. Linda West? Linda West?
No, not. No. I'm sorry, I'm just a blank. Anyway, he's the one who told me that there was these fault lines that ran right under the road and the bank, and the floor of that bank building at one time had about 1.5 inch crack all the way across the marble of it from the fault line.
Hmm. Okay, not a good place for a bank, but I'm glad I finally know which one it is. Now, at that time, was there anything developed between the bank and 360? Did 360 even exist?
Yeah, 360 was there. It was okay. But there was nothing there. Eventually, they built a movie theater, and now they have condos. But
right, okay.
But before the movie theater was there, it was just a. And it's the cemetery, the Walsh Charlton or the Walsh family cemetery is there.
Okay, and we're going to see that. We're going to see that today.
Okay.
Colleen, if you will go forward 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 to the plaque. Remember, these are our corrals that we are going to hike to. So here we go. I want to thank both Shanti and Flo for sending us a copy of this plaque about the Delana family. We talked at length last meeting about the Delana Ranch and how it went all the way from the Colorado River at the time through what is now Rollingwood and on down to Barton Creek, south of Barton Creek Square Mall. And this plaque is actually at the, more or less at the entrance to the Brookdale Senior Living area, which is off Liberty Park Drive, right in the middle of that stretch.
Mm-hmm.
And it gives a lot of history of the Delana family and was just really, really interesting. It talked about where their houses were and the different generations and what they did in the farm. I don't think they talked about the first Candido actually paid off his mortgage by selling guano from caves in the bat guano from caves in the Colorado River. He went over into the Colorado River from his ranch and found that that was a product that was in great need because fertilizer was not prevalent and people would use it as fertilizer. So he would bag it up and he would take it over to Manshack and sell it to landscape companies that were headquartered in that part of town.
And Ellen, on that same thing that I sent you about is the Delana Lane, the granddaughter of these Delanas that you talk about.
Right.
I had a phone number there for her.
Yes. And so, I'm hoping we can put together a whole program on the ranch because it certainly was in business for a number of years and had a lot of different focus areas. The thing that I liked best about this plaque is at the end of the third paragraph, that they actually discontinued the ranching operation in 1973 because the matriarch of the family was concerned about liability for cows getting out onto Bee Cave Road or the new Mopac Expressway, which cuts through part of their former ranch land. So it actually was a highway that ended the Delana Ranch. Okie dokie. Well, let's pick up our driving tour where we left off. And let's go back and figure out where we are. We're at the corner of 360 and Walt Charlton Road. We're in the parking lot of Ace Taylor. Everybody with me in terms of where we are?
Yes.
360 and Walt Charlton, that intersection. So if you come out of Ace Taylor, take a right onto Walt Charlton and first right, enter that Barton Creek Square Mall parking lot. We're going to go all the way around the perimeter, going north and east. One thing that I was fascinated by was to learn that during the Civil War, Confederate forces made a lot of gunpowder, again using guano from the bat caves. And one of the areas where they had a production facility was approximately where the mall is today. We've already talked about how this land later on became part of the Delana Ranch, and was used throughout the first half of the 1900s. And it should come as no surprise for us to realize that when the mall was constructed in 1981, it was very, very controversial. The awareness of conservation had begun to build in Austin very dramatically. Melissa brought to us last meeting the new PBS program about the green vision of Austin. So that was beginning to be part of the political scene in Austin. And not only was this a potentially destructive development in terms of the Barton Creek watershed, but also this was one of the highest and most scenic hills in the area. And if we go to the next slide, I'm sure you all have seen the spectacular views of downtown Austin from this hilltop. And does anybody remember personally the development questions? Carol, your sister was on the city council. What can you tell us about this area, about this time?
Let me unmute. I don't remember much about it. I was living, we were military family. We were living abroad at the time, but I just know it was very controversial. And she was a city planner. She had a master's in city planning.
Oh, wow.
So it was very controversial. It was a constant battle with the realtors and developers. No mm-hmm. surprise.
No and surprise.
You're not supposed to cut off any hills. Remember, that was part of the planning commission's ruling. You could not chop off, you could not reconfigure the hilltop.
Well, that hilltop is surprisingly flat to not be reconfigured. But anyway, it does make for a great, great view of downtown. All right, well, we're going to keep driving and we're going to circle back around to 360. And we're going to go past the that Ace Taylor where we just parked and the bank that is across the Walsh Charlton Street from it. And just past that bank, there's a new street called McKenna Lane. Pull in there. McKenna Lane is the back entrance to the condos that were built where the movie theater used to be that we just talked about a minute ago. And right next to this McKenna Lane is a small asphalt parking area for the Tarleton Family Cemetery. Next slide. You go into the Tarleton Family Cemetery, and I was surprised to see this mix. Usually you see a cemetery that's one or the other, but there are several graves like the one on the left that are simply marked by field stones. These are the kind of graves that tend to get lost over time because somebody thinks they're doing a good job of cleaning up the landscape, and they don't realize that that these field stones were often used by the earlier settlers to mark graves. So this cemetery is one of the best examples of where those still exist. It only has 13 graves, and some of them clearly are very well cared for and decorated as those on the right are. All righty, let's go back to the next slide.
Not working.
So Ellen, what was the time frame on that cemetery? Like, when was the earliest graveside?
That is a great question. Let me see. When is the earliest? The Tarleton family was here quite early. So let me see if I can grab that. It was established prior to 1900, so it is one of the older cemeteries in this area.
Thank you. And when was the last grave put into that?
I did not look for that. Some of them look relatively, but that would be within the last 20 years. There are only 13 graves there, so it is a very small cemetery. We're going to see a lot of cemeteries today. So, Seems like the western half cemetery of the district has a lot more cemeteries. Okay, so you from this area, from the Young Tarleton Family Cemetery, get back on 360, and hopefully you can turn around and pull out on 360, going heading with the front of your car. Go up to just past Rudy's Barbecue and turn right onto Stone Ridge Road. Just past that side entrance to Rudy's, pull into the parking lot for the Tucker Cemetery. Let's go to the next one. And this is a lovely, lovely cemetery. If you like to visit cemeteries and look at different types of stone and different engravings and that sort of thing, this is a grove of trees that's just beautiful. About 75 graves are there. There is a part, it's much bigger than I thought it would be. Tucker Teague, Short, Tracy family, and the Pierce family. Remember the Pierce home that we saw over on Rocky River Ridge?
Yeah.
That Edna Pierce and her husband, Linton Pierce, are both buried here. Our mama and our daddy are the way that the graves are marked. That's Edna's grave on the left, the picture on the left. So anyway, this is just a lovely place, and it was established prior to 1880. So that makes this the oldest, in fact, the oldest one that I'm aware of in our entire area. Even the Eanes Community Cemetery was not established until 1895. So Tucker Cemetery, and again, it's right in back of Rudy's, accessed from the Stone Ridge Road. Okay, pull back out onto 360 and head north to where Vaquero's Cafe and Cantina are. Who recalls the names of the restaurants that preceded Vaquero's in that location?
Was one Tres Amigos, or was it?
Tres Amigos.
That's it, yep.
Moved from downtown.
Does anybody remember the name of the restaurant before it was Tres Amigos?
Yes. The Cedars.
Cedars.
The Cedars. Okay, that's what the Cedars was. The Cedars.
And that was established by a warrant officer from the base, from Berkstam Air Force Base.
Okay, good to know.
That was pre-bridge also.
So that was prior to 1982. I'm guessing when you say bridge, I'm guessing, do you mean the Mopac Bridge or do you mean the
360? Pennypacker.
Okay, so the Cedars was kind of out in the middle of nowhere at that
right.
time.
Absolutely.
You had to go down Lamar and come back up.
Okay. Wow. Lamar and up. And any idea when it changed from the Cedars to Tres Amigos?
It did since when we got here. And What did we decide we got here? We got here in Shanti, you know.
You said 68 or so was when you moved.
Okay, so then, and it was a Cedars then. And okay. And my husband knew the
warrant officer?
Warrant officer, uh-huh, because they don't exist anymore in the Air Force. I don't think they might, but they were going out of whatever. But he was running it, and my husband knew him, but I did not, and I met him, but I do not remember his name at all.
Okay.
What was the name of the restaurant right across from the high school that was a hamburger place? For some reason, I thought they had something to do with Tres Amigos.
No, that was, it's still there.
People's?
No.
No. It's where the furniture exchange is. Was.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, let's go to the next slide where we're at Vaquero's.
Just one little thing. I think Tres Amigos was Los Tres Bobos downtown before it became Tres Amigos. Do y'all remember Tres Bobos? It was
yes.
Down. Yeah, okay.
Well, Bobos. That family is still around. You can still call them and ask them questions.
Okay. All right. All these are great hints. These are terrific hints. Well, what we do know is that the area where the Cedars and then Tres Amigos and now Vaqueros, that this was right at the in the heart of what was the Johnson family ranch. That the Johnson family owned property out here from the mid 1800s, that yeah. The first Johnson in the Austin area was Charles. He immigrated from Sweden in about 1854. And he was very, very talented. He was very well connected. In fact, he became best friends with Sam Houston. And when Sam Houston was deposed from being governor because he would not sign the Articles of Secession from the Union, it was Charlie Johnson who had a freight company who brought his wagon to the governor's mansion and loaded up Sam Houston and all of his belongings and took him back to Huntsville for his later years. In fact, during the, as you probably know, Travis County was one of the few counties in Texas that voted not to secede from the Union. And there was a lot of union sympathizers in the county. Charlie Johnson was one of those. And in fact, he went back to Sweden for most of the Civil War. He and his wife built had built for their family the mansion, the antebellum looking mansion that you can see from the Mopac Bridge as you go north across the lake, Lake Austin. Or Lady Bird Lake, I guess we are at that point. If you look over to the left on the north shore, the deep eddy area, there is the building there that the family sold to the American Legion in 1925, and that home still exists. So the Charles Johnson family was very prominent in the Austin area. They had property out in this Westlake area, but they did not live out here. They used it primarily for fence posts and firewood and that sort of thing. In 1881, one of their sons, Henry, decided that he was going to try his hand at farming and ranching, and so he moved out to the hill land, and he and his wife raised 13 children in a house that was somewhere right around this area. And
what was her name? Myrtle?
Her name was Emma. Henry and Emma were the parents of Edward and Winnie Johnson and Frank and Gertrude. So you may have known either Miss Gertrude yes. or Winnie. They were very active in Westfield's Presbyterian Church.
Yes, I knew Winnie. I've got a funny story for Winnie. Go ahead.
But anyway, the references that I found say that there was a fence. There was a rock fence that marked the entrance to the ranch. And it was, quote, behind Tres Amigos. Now, this rock fence shown in this photo on the left runs along the side of Tres Amigos. Or Vaqueros now. Do we think this might be the original rock fence? Anybody have information on that?
Well, I think it is because when Tres Amigos was there, the front door was on the side. The front door was on the right-hand side.
You are so right.
It was behind Tres Amigos.
Okay, I had totally forgotten that orientation difference. Okay. Yeah,
Vaqueros moved the front door so it faced the highway.
Is this where they used to put out the tortillas for the squirrels?
Yeah, feed the damn squirrels with tortillas.
Okay.
It was the raccoons.
Whatever.
Yeah, raccoons. It was raccoons.
Thank you so much for bringing that up, Todd. This really had me stumped because I have gone behind Vaqueros several times and there's a creek that runs through and it just wasn't the right topography for a fence. And then one day I was looking at the building and it dawned on me that it may be right in front of us. So if we go to the next slide, have a This is a picture of the Johnson Ranch House. When it was vacant and in disrepair, but it was still standing in 1986. They stopped farming in the, stopped ranching in the early 70s. Both of the sons who had stayed in the area and carried on the family ranch had passed away by that time. So the property began to be sold off in the 70s, including land for Westlake High School. But the ranch house still remained while the development plans were in process. Now, the references I've found say that this ranch house was next to the Republic Bank building on 360. Can anybody clarify for me exactly which building the Republic Bank would have been in the mid 80s? I'll figure it out someday, but I thought I'd start by asking this group.
I think the Republic Bank building was on the, well, I might be wrong about this, but the west side of 360, south of Bee Cave, kind of north of Lost Creek. And it was a Bank of America building. Now that seems kind of far from where you are though.
Yeah, that was the Marshall Ranch up that far.
Because I had when we first moved here in the early 80s, we had an account and it was an Interfirst Bank, I think at that time. I was thinking it'd become a Republic Bank or maybe vice versa. And then it eventually became Bank of America, and I don't think it's still open as a branch anymore, but okay. Yeah, that does seem a little far north.
There are office buildings that would have, are kind of 1980-ish on either, going in either direction. The one going north is almost adjacent to Vaquero's. The one going south is several hundred yards south. But okay, I'll keep researching that. So I'm not exactly sure where this house was, but I thought this was a fabulous picture of the house, even though it was taken when it went into disrepair.
Oh, wait a minute, which house is this? The Johnson?
This is the Johnson house. Uh-huh.
Okay.
And remember, we saw on our first half of the tour, when we were going down the outside or the western side of 360, we stopped at the Woods of Westlake Heights subdivision and looked at the smokehouse that was reasonably close in its original location to the house. There was the house, there was a barn, the smokehouse, and I think a number of several other outbuildings. Now the smokehouse, it's not in its original location either. My understanding was it was a little bit further south, but still on that western side of 360.
Is this Johnson affiliated with Winnie Johnson?
Yes, it would be.
Because Winnie Johnson's grandson, Cecil Jr., was a friend of my son's. And the last time I knew anything about him, he was the doing the editing for the Bastrop paper, newspaper.
Okay. All right.
But, shall I tell you my funny Winnie story?
Go ahead.
She had lots of figs. I'm from Ohio. We didn't grow figs in Ohio. So we were quite taken with him. Well, John and Cecil Jr. were very good friends. And one day Winnie said to John, my son John, take all the figs you want, because they're more than our family can handle. So John takes things very literally. He took every fig she had on the trees, took them down to that grocery store, you remember, on Lamar, where Schlotsky's used to be.
Yeah.
And where Lady Bird Johnson used to stop and get her groceries before she went out to the ranch. Well, anyway, he sold them to her. And I said, where'd you get all that money? And he said, I sold my figs, the figs to Fresh, was it Fresh Cut or something like that? And I said, where'd you get the figs? Miss Johnson told me to, I said, you can't, you have to share that money with her. Whether he did or not, I do not know. But anyway, it was so, he took every fig she had and sold them to the, I thought that was pretty good business, but that's not what he's doing now. Yeah, she wouldn't have cared if she knew about it.
That's great. Thank you, Flo. Bill, were you going to say something?
I was going to ask you, is the Johnson family, I mean, is that the Leif Johnson Ford family?
Not that I know of, no.
Not that I'm aware of.
Cecil's mother, whose name I can't remember, was a very good seamstress. And she took my wedding dress and fixed it so my daughter, who does not have the same body parts, I'm taller and slimmer than she. Well, anyway, and she fixed the dress so she could wear it for her wedding. So, and my granddaughter wanted to wear it for her wedding, and my daughter wouldn't let her because she said, oh, that lace is so old, it's going to tear the minute she hugs somebody. So she wore it at the rehearsal dinner, and she has a picture there. We have a picture now of me in my wedding dress, Meadow in my wedding dress, and my granddaughter in my wedding dress.
Aww.
All because of Miss Johnson could do that.
Wow. Well, yes, I think she, I understand she and Miss Gertrude Johnson, both of them were very, very talented in multiple areas. But yes. What a great story about the wedding dress. In the History Center, we do have a fabulous picture of Miss Gertrude, who made a velvet covering for a small basket that was the first collection basket used at the Eanes Chapel and eventually Westlake Hills Presbyterian Church.
Oh, great.
One of the coolest things. And a picture of her, we have the basket, but we also have a picture of her holding the basket back in the 1940s, was when that was taken. Okay, any more questions on the Johnson family? They were very influential, stalwarts of the community, on the school board. And at one point, the sons carried on the farming and ranching business. Frank was the one who sold the property for the high school. So the Johnson family just very, very integrated into the community. Cecil Johnson, who was grandson of Henry, and the father of the Cecil that you just mentioned, Flo, was probably the primary donor of artifacts to the History Center when it was organized in the 1980s. Uh-huh. That he not only had things from the Johnson Ranch, but he was friends with John Marshall, the son of the Marshall, Eanes Marshall family, who was pretty eccentric. And he married and stayed married for about 3 weeks. So he didn't have a wife to help him manage his affairs. And one day Cecil saw smoke rising from the Marshall Ranch House area. And he thought the ranch house was on fire. So he goes running up to the house. And lo and behold, John has just decided that he's tired of all the things in the house. And he's throwing them in a bonfire out in the front yard. So Cecil got his truck and convinced John to let him put the things in his truck rather than throw them away. So the few things that we have today remaining from the Marshall Ranch, I think, are probably because Cecil Johnson stepped in and saved the day. Huh. Okay, let's go to the next slide. And we're going to go back out on 360. You go through two traffic lights, the one at Woods of Westlake and then the one at Westlake High School. You're looking for the entrance to St. John Newman's Catholic Church and Mobile Loaves and Fishes. Take that entrance, which is on the right, and immediately go into the next slide. You will see a little dirt parking area and this historic marker. It marks the original location of the Eanes Marshall Ranch House. Now, if the ranch house is no longer here because it has been moved to the Eanes Elementary campus. If you remember, we saw that when the first half of our tour stopped at the Eanes Elementary campus. In the year 1999 till about 2001, the community collaborated, raised money, and moved the ranch house, which was being used by Bruce Marshall, the great grandson of Robert Eanes, as an art studio. They took it apart, moved it to the Eanes Elementary campus, and reassembled it there. So it's part of the History Center complex. This marker tells the story. But if you can envision being on that side of 360, and if you turn towards the west, look across 360 and up to the top of the highest peak across 360 at that point, you will come to what's shown on the next slide. If you were a drone and you flew over 360, you would come upon the Eanes Marshall Family Cemetery. This is part of, or its location is part of a 38-acre tract called the Marshall Tract, that is all that currently remains as undeveloped from the original ranch owned first by Robert Eanes and then purchased by his son-in-law, H.B. Marshall. It has been purchased for development, but this is the fifth development project. The other four have fallen through, so it's not clear what will become of this 38-acre tract. But there, I'm very comfortable at this point that the cemetery will be honored in whatever development goes forward. It has been included in all four of the previous plans, and so I think there is every intention to make sure that the cemetery is not desecrated in any way. Next slide. In the cemetery, the first grave is from 1882, which again is one of the earlier ones in the area. It's the grave of Eliza Eanes, who was the wife of Robert Eanes. Robert Eanes, if you remember, is the guy who was the first school trustee and built a log cabin that started education in this area, public education in this area, 150 years ago. Robert Eanes is also buried there. The marker you see on his grave was placed there during the Texas sesquicentennial. That was one of the sesquicentennial projects of this area. Next slide, please. I put this in for those of you who knew Bruce Marshall. I mentioned earlier that Bruce was the great grandson of Robert and Eliza Eanes. And this picture was taken in about 1970. So even if you didn't know Bruce, I thought you could enjoy the striped pants and the fashion statement from the 1970s. Next slide. Bruce was buried there in 2015. And he is the most recent burial. In fact, there had not been anyone buried there for, since about 1990, I believe. There are the graves of Eliza and Robert, and then their daughter, Viola, who married H.B. Marshall, the purchaser of the ranch. They're there. Three of their six children are there. And then Bruce is their great-grandson. So a small family cemetery that often gets confused with the Eanes Community Cemetery, the one we saw over on the Eanes Elementary campus. Okay, so again,
where was Bruce's wife buried?
That's a good question. She has only died recently. Is that correct?
Yeah. After he did, yes.
I have not been able to find that obituary, so I will put that on my list of questions. Where's Anne?
I went to Bruce's funeral.
And I'm guessing, did they have a graveside up in this cemetery or no graveside at the cemetery?
I don't know.
Okay, I will see if I can figure out where she is buried. There's no indication that she was buried at this cemetery. But I will see if I can figure that out. Okay, so we're still standing in front of the historic marker about the Eames Marshall Ranch. And we've looked across 360 up on the hill in the woods. That's where the cemetery is. If you look south, back down 360 from where we've just come, you see the intersection of Lost Creek Boulevard and 360. And it's thought that this is approximately where the original cabin was that Robert Eanes and his family used when they first came from Mississippi in 1872, that their dwelling was somewhere in the neighborhood of this intersection. That makes sense when you look at where the cemetery is placed. Cemeteries were typically placed at a high point, relatively close to the where the family still lived. After the ranch was sold to H.B. Marshall and he married Viola, at some point, in the 1880s, the young couple dismantled the house from this location and moved it further north, a couple of hundred yards, to where the historical marker is on 360, and they rebuilt it. So what we can say is that we know that a lot of the foundation stones and the chimney stones were reused. My guess is the wood that you currently see in the Eanes Marshall Ranch House on Eanes Elementary campus may not have made it through both of these iterations over the years. But one question I get a lot is exactly where was the Eanes Marshall Ranch House before it was moved to the Eanes Elementary campus? So the next slide will show us that. When you're standing at that historical marker, walk down the driveway towards the Mobile Loaves and Fishes commissary. When you get to the commissary, which is a remodeled house where Anne and Bruce Marshall lived for many years, turn to the north and look across the driveway. You'll see this stucco shed at the end of a path. It's used today for Boy Scout storage. It used to be the shed that was on the right-hand end of the ranch house. So this area on the left that now has no structure, that's where the two-story ranch house was exactly. The reason that HB and Viola Eanes Marshall moved the house from the intersection of Lost Creek Boulevard to this location was to be closer to the headwaters of Smith Creek, a place called Monkey Springs. It made a lot of sense. Water was critical. They wanted to be closer to the water source. So they moved it to this location, and then it was moved from this location to Eanes Elementary in 2001.
So, Ellen, that's Smith Creek, is that maybe the creek that runs behind Vaqueros that you were referring to earlier?
I think that is primarily a wet weather creek, which probably feeds into it. My guess is it flows north towards the St. John Newman's property. That whole basin begins to drain down through, and Smith Creek has all of those pieces that come into it as it moves towards Eanes Elementary. Okay. And then it actually goes through the Tremont section. It goes between Cedar Creek Elementary and Hill Country Middle School, and then on down
right.
through
Tremont. Oh yeah, right.
And then behind the Finish Line Car Wash.
Yeah.
That's the same creek. So it drains, you know, it continues on through.
So that's what floods.
Yes, that is what floods so badly now.
When you get a big rain.
And it starts right up here at the Mobile Loaves and on the St. John Newman's property And here is where you have the springs. If you remember in the last presentation, I showed you pictures of the creek that had black holes in it.
Right.
Yeah. It's along this first stretch where all of those springs are. And that's what attracted, certainly that's what it made the Eanes Marshall Ranch very livable.
Right. Interesting.
Okay, let's move on. All righty, we're going to go back out onto Loop 360, go north to Bee Cave Road exit underneath the 360 bridge, and come out with a left at the 7-Eleven onto Castle Ridge Road. Next slide, you will see that the thing we're going to look for on Castle Ridge Road is the Brown Cemetery. It's a little bit hard to find. It's back about 100 feet off to the right. And it's really not marked with a sign saying Brown Cemetery. It's marked with a sign like this one on the left. It's a newer cemetery because the family lived in the area until the 1950s. And so there are more recent graves there. But most of the people in the cemetery were descendants of Jasper Brown, who moved to this area prior to 1900 and at one point had about 4,000 acres in the Knollwood and Camelot areas. He lost much of that for failure to pay taxes, but he did accumulate it at one time. Most of his descendants lived either along Tucker Lane, which was the original name for Walt Charlton, or along Brown Lane, which we just indicated it was the original name of Castle Ridge Road. Okay, back out to Bee Cave, and we're going to a place where you've probably all been. Next slide. And that's the County Line Restaurant. In the History Center, we have a pair of keys pictured in that upper left-hand picture. The Cedar Crest Lodge keys. Anybody remember or hear stories of the private club known as the Cedar Crest Lodge?
No.
My guess is that this might have been a speakeasy type of private club during Prohibition as well. Not quite sure that it was that old because these keys come from the 1950s. But this building, the County Line building, is definitely of that era in terms of the 1920s to the 1950s being built there. Okay, come back out to Bee Cave. And as you come back to Bee Cave Road from the County Line, you are coming into the area that at one point was the massive ranch owned by the Roy family, the Rob Roy Ranch. Namesake, of course, is the Rob Roy subdivision today. You're looking for Addie Roy Road, which is just past Barton Creek Boulevard. Interestingly, Addie Roy Road, even in the 1990s, was actually Bee Cave Road. And it wasn't until Bee Cave Road went through one of its improvement phases that Bee Cave Road was straightened out. And the curve, which is truly a semicircle, Addie Roy Road is a semicircle off of Bee Cave Road. And that curve was straightened out in the 1990s. But it's worth taking because, next slide, when you get to 301 Addie Roy Road, you can see the original Rob Roy Ranch House. The best way to find it is to look for a very intricate wrought iron fence that once stood in front of one of the Covert mansions, Covert family mansions in town. When that was taken down, the Rob Roy family put it in front of their house. The story on the Rob family is that Cal Roy and his wife purchased 1,200 acres around where this house is in 1895. Now, eventually they amassed up to 3,000 acres and the Rob Roy or the Roy Ranch, it's hard to say, went all the way from the Colorado River to Barton Creek. So if you look at a map, you can just see they had this huge swath of land and Bee Cave Road bisected it right in the middle. The father eventually died and the ranch passed to his children, Rob, Addie, and Jesse. Neither of these children ever married and didn't really live on the ranch. They basically lived in town. They received their education in town, but they spent their summers and their vacations and came to really love this area of the county.
I can just put down my bed. Pardon me.
That if you you may be aware that Westlake High School awards about 20 Roy scholarships every year to graduating seniors. Those scholarships are from a trust that was set up after the three children, Rob, Addie, and Jesse, all passed away. Because they never married and did not have their own children, they put their money in trust for scholarships for Westlake High School and Austin High School students. Okay, let's go back out to Bee Cave Road. And if you think about this section of Bee Cave Road, One World Theater is on the left, and there is a storage facility on the right. Think about how narrow that ridgetop is right through that section. Well, it earns its name. It's called the Narrows. That historically, that's what it was called because it was the Bee Cave Road went across the top of that craggy hill. All right, we're going to go all the way out to Cuernavaca Road, turn right, and go all the way down to the end of Cuernavaca. And the next slide will show us that we will be rewarded way down at the end, close to the river where Cuernavaca and River Hills Road meet. We find two historic cemeteries. They're right next to each other. One is Allen McNeil, the other is Fowler. The Allen McNeil is a much older cemetery founded before 1900. Fowler is mainly 20th century. At about 1870 or so, Wilson and Catherine McNeil moved from San Saba to land along a creek in this area, which interestingly is actually the original Eanes Creek. People tend to call Smith Creek, the one that we talked about a few minutes ago that goes behind Eanes Elementary, between Cedar Creek and Hill Country, through Tremont, Smith Creek, but TxDOT these days calls that Eanes Creek. There actually is a creek very close to these cemeteries that it was originally named Eanes Creek, and no good reason. I've never found a good reason as to why it was. The Eanes apparently did not own property out here, but it could have been because it was associated with the school community. Huh. The McNeils and the Allens, as far as I can tell, aren't related. They were neighbors, and so they went together to form this cemetery, and they donated the land for it. Okay, let's go to the next slide.
Ellen, why did you say that it was called the Fowler Cemetery?
That's a separate cemetery that's right next door to the
I see. Oh, okay. Well,
yeah.
What about the Fowlers?
Don't know much about them. They were family that came later, and not, as far as I've been able to find, did not have huge land holdings. The Allen family and the McNeil family both had large ranches in the area for several generations.
Right.
I might add that Wick Fowler of the Chili fame is buried there at the Fowler Cemetery.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, how cool. That is so, thank you, Gail.
You're welcome.
Yeah. Are you part of the family by any chance?
No, but some of the family lived in Fort Worth, and I knew that, and I knew when he died and was buried down here. I can't remember. I knew another little tidbit, but if I think of it, I'll let you know.
Okay. Tell us, Gail, tell us more about the Fowler chili.
Oh, Wick Fowler chili has been sold for years in the stores in a box with their secret recipe. It's real easy to open up all the packets and take measurements, and so you can buy your own chili powder or whatever. But yeah, I send it every year to England to some friends who fell in love with it. And our trip a couple of years ago, I took as many as I could fit into my bag to them because they love it. But it's available now still at the stores. So you can, when you see it, that's the family.
And I know years and years ago, I have a niece through my aunt, so not blood related, who worked for the Fowlers for a long time, years ago.
Okay.
Everybody needed info that way.
Okay. Sounds like there's a lot of interesting stories to find out about the Fowler family. Okay, great. Let's backtrack up Cuernavaca. And if you're driving this, you go to the intersection with Mecca Road. Be real careful here because oncoming traffic does not stop. Mecca is kind of the right of way. So Cuernavaca swings into Mecca without stopping. But you will turn and we'll go to the next slide. As soon as you turn onto Mecca, you see this great sign called Austin Lake Estates, and you go into Austin Lake Estates. Have any of you ever been down here?
Yes.
We're in my neck of the woods now.
Okay.
Not quite that far down, but
yeah, mine too. I just live a few blocks from there. Okay. I'm not far away at all. It's funny when they repaved Cuernavaca Road, I guess in the early 80s, they tried to change the stop sign so that Mecca would stop and the outroar, you know, they only lasted for a few weeks and the stop signs were reversed back to the original traffic flow.
Okay. Well, this was the original traffic flow.
Yeah.
And I'm sounds like several of you can add a lot in this, but I was fascinated by this story. And just as an aside, yesterday I found a topographic map from an aerial photograph taken of this area in 1953. And I was looking for Cuernavaca Road. There was no such thing. It was called Duffy Road.
Right. That's right.
And rightfully so, because in the late 1940s, Charles Duffy owned a huge bit of ranch land in this area, the Seabar Ranch. And you find it spelled both ways that I have here on the slide. So he had over 1,000 acres, and he took 1,300 of those acres and developed them into this dream playland. He first called it Seabar Ranch Lakeview Acres, but later it was renamed Lake Austin Estates. The history on this is that post-war, there was a boom in demand for vacation and resort-like homes. And because of the weather and because of the topography and the beauty of this area, he recognized that opportunity for land development. So he planned a subdivision to meet the post-war demand for these vacation and retirement homes. And this was right after the Marshall Ford Dam had been constructed. So right after the lake was formed. And to give you an idea of how popular this was, between 1958 and 1960, 300 lots were sold in Lake Austin Estates in that 2-year period.
Wow. You know what? When you see, there's a Seabar Volunteer Fire Department.
Right.
And I never knew why it was called Seabar, but now I do.
That I think it probably came from the Seabar Ranch.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah. And now we know the rest of the story.
And if you we go to the next slide, please.
The original Seabar Fire Station was just to the to the right of that sign, I mean, the entrance. The story I've always heard on the entrance there is that it was designed to keep mobile homes out. Because the Lake Hill, Lawston Lake Estates, they didn't want mobile homes. And now the deed restriction said your house had to be site built and it had to be at least 600 square feet. I'm sure some of them just barely made that. But in Austin Lake Estates proper, there are no mobile homes. There are mobile homes in Village West, which is just, you know, half a quarter mile away. But there's no mobile homes in Austin Lake Estates. And I've always heard that's the reason for the gate. And that's why they don't want the gate taken down. Of course, now it's just, you know, now it's just sentimental value. But
yeah, now it's very, very vintage. So why?
Yeah,
why
very was vintage. I always thought that was kind of a cute story.
Yeah, thank you for that. That the next slide will indicate that on the right, you see the original Seabar Ranch House that was built in 1926. Mm-hmm. And it still stands. It's on Rivera Road. And just around the corner is Edgewater Drive, which is where some of the first resort homes were built. And that's where the neighborhood amenities were built. That Mr. Duffy really had a vision here that not only could he sell the water and the scenic beauty, but he also had very unique terrain for a post-war recreation area. The terrain was so varied, he could sell lakefront, lake view, and high view lots. So that's how these were marketed. The amenities included a boat launch, a lighted beach, a playground, horse stables and trails, a pool, and a picnic area. Many of those still available to the neighborhoods today. And one of the most unique things, and this may be tied to the trailer thing, is that he did not require that owners build within a specific time frame. And so that is why, even though those lots sold like hotcakes between 1958 and 1960, the build out of these lots was much slower, and you find real eclectic design styles. Variety of styles because they were built over time, and certainly things continue to change. But the oldest homes are down along Edgewater Drive. Anything else you neighbors can tell us about Lake Austin Estates? Okay, well, let's go back out to Cuernavaca and then go back several miles to Common Forge Road. Now, when you get to Common Forge Road, I found several references that call the hill that you see coming from the river towards Common Forge Road, they called it Turkey Foot Hill because the terrain resembled a turkey foot. Well, I thought, okay, but how can you tell a hill looks like a turkey foot? Well, last month when Eliza Blackman was giving her presentation, she showed us a topographic map from 1896. And she was explaining a point about the topography and where the springs were. And I was doing a happy dance because that topography map shows very clearly the turkey foot. The next slide, I'm gonna see if you can see it. Can you see the turkey foot?
Yeah.
Look, I couldn't believe it. It was like, oh my gosh, that's the turkey foot. Right there. And also something I noticed is, Colleen, if you'll put the corner where Cuernavaca comes into Common Fords, more to the right where Cuernavaca, yeah, that's Cuernavaca. Yeah, bring it all the way towards Common Fords. There you go. And it dead ends into Common Fords. The same thing is shown on the 1953 map. So I believe that connection between Cuernavaca at Common Forge and Cuernavaca at Bee Cave, it was probably straightened out in a later, after 1953 of some sort. Did anybody live in the area prior to that?
We lived in the area. We lived there since 79, and you had to make the turn there. Commons Ford intersected with BK Road. Cuernavaca did not. Okay. And there was no traffic light. And so it kept backing up and backing up and backing up, and it got worse and worse and worse. Sometimes the deputy sheriff would just stop out of the goodness of his heart and direct traffic in the mornings. Because when you came up Commons Ford Road, it was kind of a blind intersection with B Cave Road and really dangerous.
Which is only two lanes.
And it's only two lanes. B Cave Road was two lanes at the time, and of course Commons Ford Road was two lanes. They changed that alignment. They pushed Cuernavaca all the way through to B Cave Road in probably the early 80s, probably 82 or 83, probably.
When they widened the road.
And that's when they widened B Cave Road to four lanes. And so that's why, and they put in a traffic light at the same time, which was, you know, we love the traffic light because we live down that way. But of course, if you don't live down that way, you'd hate the traffic light.
But the traffic was a little later. Yes, we moved over in 89 and it was still Commons Ford Road. It didn't change until sometime after that. We moved over here in 89.
I moved out here in 79.
Right, but it was still Commons Ford when we moved over that ran into B Cave. So it was a little bit later than that when they changed it to Cuernavaca.
It had to be the mid 80s.
Because it was when Westridge.
It was when Westridge Middle School opened. It was that same year. So that would have been the mid 80s, right?
Okay.
Of course.
All right, I'll see if I can research that. But y'all have given a lot of information about this. And you know, I have found old references that talked about the turnoff of Common Ford from B Cave. And I didn't really understand that until I saw this map.
Well, it was pretty dangerous because it was a really steep hill. You had to go up a very steep hill. There was a stop sign at the top. And so for those of us that had manual transmission cars, it was always a trick, especially in the mornings when the traffic would back up and you'd be back 20 cars. You'd have to creep up the hill to get to B Cave Road.
Yep.
Well, okay. Hey Todd, is that the is that now going to go behind the church where they're just
It still goes behind. You can walk it, or you can drive about half of it, you know, and then you can walk the rest of the way up to B Cave Road. Of course, it's all grown over now.
So there's going to be a stoplight there in the next. Well, it's set up.
No, that's to the church, and that's about maybe 50 or 60 yards to the west of the old intersection.
Okay, so it didn't come through that intersection.
No.
Okay.
Yeah. All right, let's go through the next three slides pretty quickly because we almost everybody saw the presentation last month about the Common Forge Ranch. Now, Portrait of Community shows that this was part of the Allen Ranch. Remember the Allen McNeil Family Cemetery that we saw down at the end of Cuernavaca? That the Allen Ranch apparently was several thousand acres. In her research, Eliza did not find references to the Allens, but I'm not sure she went back to that. I was looking at that specific time frame. So I've got some more work to do here, but the portrait book does say that this was the Allen Ranch. And Herbert Allen was a very prominent citizen of the western part of our school district for a long number of years. He was a trustee of the Bruton Springs School. He was a student, and then I think he even tried his hand at teaching, and then he was a trustee for a number of years of the Bruton Springs School. So apparently the first location of that school was in a house that was on the quote old Allen Ranch. So we know that the Bruton Springs School was in and around several different locations here. But as Eliza told us, the Baldwin family bought the property in 1953 and renamed it the Resaca Ranch. And then in 83, the city of Austin bought it as a park, and now it's Commons Ford. And she told us all about the barn and the log cabin. She didn't tell us a whole lot about prairie restoration, but Janice Sturrock, who joins our group most of the time, is part of that team doing the restoration. So maybe we can get her to talk about that at some point. All right, let's go out, back out Cuernavaca and to B Cave. Continue going west until you get to the traffic light to turn into the Barton Creek West neighborhood. go down Cliffs Edge Parkway, do a U-turn and come back the other side of the greenbelt, and immediately in the grass on the right-hand shoulder, you will see a little turnoff that is hidden by grass. This is where you have to trespass lightly because there are two fences that block access to the Roberts Cemetery. The Roberts family, again, very prominent ranchers out in the western area of the district. But this has Roberts family, the Simpson family, Teague, and the Hudson families. You go, the one on the gate on the left is visible from the road, sneak around that, and you go to the cemetery itself, which is gated and well taken care of. And the next slide shows the Texas historical marker that gives you background on this cemetery. It was noted, obviously, the Roberts family cemetery for the pioneer families that are buried there. But in much the same way that now we know Wick Fowler was buried in the Fowler Cemetery, Buck Simpson, who was one of the most highly decorated World War I veterans and is very renowned in these parts, Buck Simpson was buried there. And it's because he is buried there that the Texas Historical Commission granted this designation. Okay, these instructions are a little bit dense reading, but take the Creek Edge Parkway till you get to Scenic Bluff. It's the cut through from the neighborhood to Westridge Middle School. Get to Westridge Middle School and bear left, taking the road, it's called Emma Avenue, that connects Westridge with the Barton Creek Elementary School. If you've ever been out there, you will realize what a deep ravine lies between those two schools. That's called Heffington's Hollow. It was named for a guy who was the tax assessor of Travis County, and he settled in the area out west while Robert Eanes was forming the school and settling in the area right around Bee Cave and Campcraft Road area. So you dead end into Patterson Road, which is the road that runs in front of Barton Creek Elementary School. Take a right and just 20 feet or so down the road, look for the Patterson Riley Cemetery. I was searching for it way down by the creek, spent hours on the other end of Patterson Road, but it's really just several hundred yards past Barton Creek Elementary School. It's a relatively newer cemetery. Oldest grave there is 1913. And it has some markers that are simple concrete, like the one on the left, but it also has marble markers that are more modern. Number of different pioneer families are buried there. And just to tie it back to some of the other people we've learned about, Peyton Patterson, patriarch of this family, he married Katie Riley. The Riley family is another pioneer family. They married and at one point they owned about 1,000 acres along what is now Patterson Road. One of their daughters was Edna Pierce, after she married Linton Pierce at age 14 and a half. So a lot of these families, their ties together in multiple ways. It was from the Patterson family that the school district bought the land for Barton Creek and Westridge in 1984. That's when that purchase was made. Okay. On Patterson Road from the cemetery, go north, and this is towards Bee Cave Road. Then go back down Bee Cave past Barton Creek Boulevard and pull into the Westlake Hills Presbyterian Church. Hopefully you're with me mentally. Pull into the Presbyterian Church. Before we see a picture of that, though, I want to ask if anybody remembers this bell. I don't remember if we talked about it in December. But you notice that there is a bell hanging in a tower between two very different looking buildings.
In school.
Yes. The building on the right is the very dilapidated frame schoolhouse. This picture is from the early 30s, and the schoolhouse really was beginning to be dilapidated. It was torn down in 1936, and the rock schoolhouse that exists today was built in its place in 1937. But that's the old schoolhouse. We know that it was, the picture was taken after 1932-ish, because in the background you can see the rock building that was built as the Eanes Chapel that evolved into Westlake Hills Presbyterian Church. Well, between those two, there's the bell tower with this very, very heavy iron bell. This bell came from the Austin Fire Department, and it was given to the Eanes School community when the community started building that chapel building. The Austin Fire Department didn't need it anymore because they were city slickers and they had electricity. So they had electrified their alarm system. So they brought their bell, their old fashioned bell, alarm bell for their fire department to the Eanes community, and this was built. Now, the reason I wanted to show you this, and we have several pictures, by the way, of when the chapel was being built, and the bell is sitting out in front of the chapel building. So it was definitely part of the community. But if you go to the next slide, you will see that that same bell is visible today in a very different tower. That if you're in the parking lot at Western Hill, at Westlake Hills Presbyterian Church, you'll be looking straight at it. It's right in front of the entrance to the main sanctuary. Mm-hmm. And it has followed Westlake Hills Presbyterian Church to three locations over the last 90 years. The first location was on the Eanes Elementary campus. Mm-hmm. The second location was at the corner of Westlake Drive. Yeah, corner of Westlake Drive and Bee Cave Road. And then the third location here on the corner of Barton Creek Boulevard and Bee Cave Road. All right, back out to Bee Cave Road. And this is a more recent place. In fact, it still exists. This is the Grove Restaurant. The Grove, I believe, took its name from this massive oak tree that the property is graced with. Can anybody tell me what this oak tree that is now at the Grove, do you remember what it sheltered for three decades?
Yes, the Episcopal Church.
St. Michael's Episcopal Church before.
Absolutely.
A lot of professors at UT went there.
That my memory was that it was a almost a pavilion, an outdoor pavilion that had been screened in, that was used as their fellowship hall.
Yes, it was called the Goat Shed.
The Goat Shed.
I can say that. That's my church, and also Rhodus.
Okay. Oh, Gail can tell us all about that because it has great history.
Rhoda would know better than I.
Either of you want to share any stories?
You go ahead.
No, go ahead. I'm getting a call. Go ahead.
Well, I'm not a member of that church, so I don't remember the but I have people who could tell you the everything about it.
Right, that I used to collaborate a lot. I'm a member of Westlake Methodist Church and collaborated a lot with folks from the Episcopal Church. And I would always hope that they would invite us to meet at their place because it was just such an incredible location. This almost screen kind of rustic building that was virtually interlaced among the limbs of this tree. Is what I remember, but a beautiful, beautiful site before St. Michael's sold this property and moved to the location, their current location, which is along 360.
So Flo, did Chartier Newton design the original Episcopal Church?
Yeah, yes, he did, and he didn't need any. He designed. He designed it so that you don't need any microphones or anything. You, every place you spoke, you could hear them, and that was really, really important.
And was that the old Episcopal Church, or was that the current Episcopal Church?
St. Michael's moved out to 360.
Right. And,
The architect for both of the churches.
Okay.
Yes, so right.
Okay. And what was his first name?
Chartier.
Is that Patricia's husband?
Husband, yes. But Patricia is no longer, her memory's gone, but there's a lot of people that belong to that church that are still living that could tell you lots of stuff about
them. Great.
And one of the interesting things, Doris Walcott, who started the library, also was one of the founders of the Westlake Episcopal Church. And it was her son who was one of the founders of County Line.
Okay. Son, County Line. All right. All right. Somebody will need to write a book someday and make all these connections. Okay. We'll have to draft Linda Vance here.
Somebody is Ellen.
We're all behind you. We'll all stand in line to buy your book and have you sign it.
Okay, let's keep moving. We're almost done. We're going to end our tour back inside the loop on Bee Cave Road. And I will say, I know I am missing an important part of our area, and that is the 360 arm that goes from this intersection at Bee Cave Road down to Pennybacker Bridge. There's St. Stephen's School. There's the Chautauqua and the steamboats of olden day on the lake. There's a new development called the Addy, I'm sure named after Addy Roy, because again, this was part of the Roy Ranch. Right. There is the Austin Country Club. How did Austin Country Club end up in the middle of the Westlake Hills? There are all sorts of questions to answer about that branch, but I just hadn't gotten there yet. So I'm going to end our tour here with the next slide, which is just one of my favorite, favorite corners in all of this area. That, as many of you know, Pat Swanson owned a nursery called Pots and Plants for several decades on this corner. And I had always heard the story that he got into a dispute with the city of Westlake Hills about a new sign. And so instead of a sign, he did the flamingos. But actually in the last week or so, I have found an interview with Pat, and he tells a story that's somewhat different, that they actually started putting a flamingo out because somebody called and asked them if they sold flamingos. And every time they put them out, they were sold immediately. So they realized how popular they were, and then it became kind of a community celebration that people would bring Santa hats to put on the flamingos. They would put Easter eggs among the flamingos in the springtime, that it really became a community thing. And it was that to which the city of Westlake Hills objected. But public opinion prevailed, and finally the city of Westlake Hills says, call them off, call the public off, we'll let you keep your flamingos. So as long that as
was, Henrietta Jacobs was the one who was really against it. Henrietta Jacobs, she was on the school board and everything, on the city council.
But they eventually decided, the Westlake Hills eventually backed down by saying it was like artwork or sculpture.
They called right. it fine art. They found a piece of the city regulations that allowed them to make exceptions for fine art. So in fact, the name of the article I found was How the Flamingos Became Fine Art. but anyway, a lot of fun. And Now it's the home of Hat Creek Burgers, and they still put out the flamingos every once in a while. They don't keep them out there all the time, but they do on special occasions, like, for example, when the Shap football team is playing state championship, that the flamingos come out and cheer them on. But I just thought that the flamingos made a fabulous statement about the independence and the resilience of all of the people that have loved, learned, and lived in these hills for centuries, and the stories that they can tell us, and how much we can celebrate what we've learned from them and what we hope to pass on to the future generations. So with that, we're at the end of our tour.
Wow, what a great presentation. Yeah.
Yes. Thank you. It has been so fun, and y'all have added so much. And from the December meeting, so much was added. I realized that this really is a work in progress, and I need to continue to add to it. So if any of you have suggestions or information or ideas, please let me know, and I will continue to improve this so that we have a thing we can store in the collection that can be used over time.
Maybe go on with that third sequel that you were describing, the other part.
Uh-huh.
And that towards the country
club. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, the third part.
Now, how long has the country club been there? Does anybody know?
Oh.
The 1980s.
Early to mid-80s.
It was the early 80s, because when they developed that subdivision, the Davenport, it was part of the Davenport development. And so it was, that would have been in 82, 83, somewhere around there.
Yeah.
And it technically it is in the city of Austin. So I guess that's why it's the Austin Country Club. It shouldn't be in the city of Austin, but it technically is. So.
Well, you know, Pennybacker Bridge opened up in 1982. So
right.
In that area.
It's like a year later or something.
Yeah, because you could get to it from the north side at that
point. Correct.
So that opened up probably a lot more, a much easier way to get there. I was surprised, you mentioned that it's in the city of Austin. I was surprised at how early the city of Austin actually annexed the river banks. I learned from the Statesman last week the tax issue that's going on now, and whether or not the riverfront properties need to pay tax. That law went into effect, or that annexation went into effect.
It was all the way back when that was still Lake McDonald, because they
1895.
Yeah, 1895, because they wanted to protect their city reservoir. I mean, to them, that was city water supply. And they were trying to protect the city water supply. So they annexed the lake, and then, you know, up, I forgot how far up the contour line to, you know, like 5 feet up, you know, the contour line 5 feet up. So that's why the city boundary goes through people's lots. Sometimes it goes right through the middle of their house, because the front yard's above 5 feet and the house, the backyard's below 5 feet above the lake. And so the city line isn't straight. It just follows the contours.
And as a person who lives right on the lake, I can tell you I'm very grateful that the contour line is on the edge of my property, so I only pay a little bit of Austin.
Oh, very lucky, very lucky.
I'm very lucky.
Yeah. Maybe you could get some fill dirt, you know, and fill in the back of your lot, and then you wouldn't be in the city at all.
Yes. Helen, there's a couple of comments, wonderful comments about the presentation, and somebody wants to know when we're going to do our walking tour.
Our walking tour of the corrals?
Yes.
soon. How's that?
Weather.
Yeah, better weather. Someone else said we need to explore the old house that's still on the Lakeville Country Club golf course.
Lost Creek golf course.
Okay.
Yeah. And is it the one that they actually are using the rock house, the rock cabin, on Lost Creek Country Club? They're actually using it as a teaching location for golf. They have one of those screens, and you know how the instructors, they use video cameras and you swing and that sort of thing, all that set up inside this historic rock cabin. Is that the one you're talking about, or is there also a log cabin that still exists? I thought the logs. Hey, Alex, I'm glad you got here. you think there's a second? You think there's another cabin that's still there? I've seen a picture of a cabin that was in terrible disrepair. It was falling apart, that was on the property. But I can inquire about that.
Ellen, I can give you a name of a friend of mine whose dad managed the Lost Creek Ranch. Okay. I'll send you that. And she and her husband, I think, could tell you some of these things. But I think that original wood house that was in the parking lot was demolished. I'm not sure.
I think I have heard that as well, but I'm not sure.
I'll send you the name of the couple that I think might could give you a little help on that.
Okay, that would be
excellent. Ellen, somebody was asking where the plaque that Shanti gave us exactly is located.
I'll give a stab at it. And Shanti, if I misrepresent it, let me know. But if you go to the entrance to Brookdale, the senior living community, which is off Liberty Park Drive, actually from Bee Cave Road, you take a left on Montebello, then a left on Liberty Park, and then look for the entrance signs to Brookdale. But don't go into Brookdale. Go slightly to the left, and you'll see a gate. There's a gated community of townhomes, very elegant looking townhomes behind that gate. It's right there between the-
You've already passed it once you get to the gate. You've passed it once you get to the gate. It's on your left-hand side.
It's more towards the Brookdale entrance, right? And the plaque does say that that is the location of the last house the Delana family lived in. They built it over a 3-year period between 1950 and 1953. And the remaining family member lived there until 1999. And I was so curious as to, you know, exactly how that fit with the ranch, and because they had lived over on what is now the north side of Bee Cave Road, at the intersection of Bee Cave Road and Delana Lane, which is just behind Park Hills Baptist Church. I mean, it would be like the very first right, kind of going into and through the new office buildings that are there. But I found this aerial map of 1953, and we can, I think we could spend a whole hour looking at that map and putting dots together, because on that map, you can actually see exactly the hilltop that the Delana family house was on. And sure enough, it's right there at the entrance to Brookdale. Does that answer the question enough?
I'll copy the chat, Ellen, and send it to you. So if there's anybody else has any questions.
Okay, and do we know who's here? Is there anybody, if there's anybody here that I am not sending the monthly email to, Amanda, hey, so glad you're with us. I owe you a communication, and I do need to add you to the list. So I will make sure and do that.
Well, Ellen, an easy way to find the plaque is come to see me. I'm in assisted living, and come and see me. And then when you leave me, as you go out, you're going to hit that. If you don't turn left, you're going to hit that plaque.
Okay.
But you have to come see me.
So I'd love to come see you. And it's kind of right at the end of the independent living units.
It's past those. But you're not allowed in yet. We're still shut down.
Okay. Someday soon.
I have to leave, but thanks. That was wonderful. Wonderful. I have it recorded, which means I'm going to see it again. Thank you.
I did record it, so if somebody missed it and wants to watch it again.
Yeah, so good to see you. Talk to you, Flo. Thanks so much for all your contributions. Let me see. Gail, do I have your email? Are you still on here? Is Gail still with us? And Susan, which Susan are you? Do I have you on the email list?
It might be Susan from genealogy.
No, it's Susan Plotch. Oh, hey, Susan. Okay, and I owe you the presentation from last week. I need to send that to you and to Bill. Was there anybody else who wanted me to send them Eliza Blackman's presentation from last month?
Gail's computer died, so that's what happened to her. But I'm here.
Is that Roy?
No, this is Glenn Reed. Gail's in the house. I'm in my office.
Oh, okay.
Her computer died, so I'll relay that to her if you don't have her on it.
Okay, and if y'all want to give me an email address, if you want to put an email address in the chat, I can add you into the monthly email that I send that tells what the program's going to be, and then share additional information as we have it.
I'm already on it, so.
Oh, okay. All right, cool. Cool. Good to have you with us, Glenn. And is there another Ellen besides me? Because I'm showing a square that says Ellen. Do I have your email? Okay.
Okay. Sorry, I'm going to have to stop us, but this was wonderful. And I will send you the chat, Ellen, okay?
Okay, great. Thank you. That let me look at the calendar. We will meet again on March the 8th. So we won't interfere with spring break. If anybody has spring break plans.